Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to our time of worship together here today, Martin Luther. We are in the season of end times, and today is Sunday of Last Judgment, where we remember that Jesus is indeed coming again to raise all the dead and to judge all people. And we look to see how we might look forward to that day with joy and have our confidence in Him. We'll begin with our first hymn. It's number 208. After that, we'll be using the Common Service in the Red Booklets. Hymn 208.
Sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior Jesus Christ.
has been merciful to us and has given his only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Those who are kneeling may stand. We continue on page 8. In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord.
Thank you.
second lesson is from Hebrews chapter 9. It compares the high priest's work in the temple with Jesus' final work, after which he entered heaven. How Jesus the first time came to fulfill his work as our great high priest, how his second return will especially be as our king. For Christ did not enter a handmade sanctuary, a representation of the true sanctuary. Instead, he entered into heaven itself, now to appear before God on our behalf. And he did not enter to offer himself many times, as the high priest enters the most holy place year after year with blood that is not his own. Otherwise, he would have needed to suffer many times since the creation of the world. But now he has appeared once and for all, at the climax of the ages, in order to take away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And just as it is appointed for people to die only once, and after this comes the judgment, so also Christ was offered only once to take away the sins of many, and he will appear a second time without sin to bring salvation to those who are eagerly waiting for him. This is the word of the Lord. Alleluia. Watch therefore, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming. Alleluia. Please stand for the gospel. The gospel according to John chapter 5. Indeed, the Son does exactly what the Father does. For the Father loves the Son and shows him everything he is doing. And he will show him even greater works than these, so that you will be amazed. For just as the Father raises the dead and gives them life, so also the Son gives life to those he wishes. In fact, the Father judges no one, but has entrusted all judgment to the Son, so that all should honor the Son just as they honor the Father. Whoever does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. Amen, amen, I tell you. Anyone who hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life. He is not going to come into judgment, but has crossed over from death to life. Amen, amen, I tell you. A time is coming, and is here now, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who listen will live. For just as the Father has life in himself, so also he has granted the Son to have life in himself, and he has given him authority to execute judgment, because he is the Son of Man. Do not be amazed at this, for a time is coming when all who are in their graves will hear his voice and will come out. Those who have done good will rise to live, but those who have practiced evil will rise to be condemned. I can do nothing at all on my own. I judge only as I hear, and my judgment is just. For I do not seek my own will, but the will of him who sent me. This is the gospel of the Lord. On page 12, we confess the Christian faith together with the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became a holy human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets.
We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Why are some saved but not others must depend entirely on God.
And then he would end up saying, well, God must choose some people for salvation, but choose other people for condemnation. Now, that makes sense to human reason, but that is not compatible with what Scripture teaches at all, is it? Because the Bible clearly says God, our Savior, wants all people to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. The only sense in which you can say that God wills some people to be condemned is as a consequence of his judgment, that they have rejected him, and therefore that is the judgment that Christ proclaims on the last day. Well, if it isn't in God who is saved and who isn't, then the only other alternative is that it's in us. And so reason would say, well, that must mean then that some people choose to believe and be saved and to love God and to obey God, and other people choose to reject God and therefore are condemned. However, that answer also is one that does not stand according to the words of Scripture. Time and again, the Scriptures say that by nature we are dead in our transgressions and sins without any capability of bringing ourselves closer to God, no capability in ourselves to come to faith that must be God's work. In fact, our natural opinion is one of being opposed to him and one of taking the idea of salvation as a gift of God and saying, no thanks, I'd rather do it myself because I think I can. The only answer that can stand to that question, why are some saved and not others, is to state two things that do not stand with each other, but yet they're exactly what Scripture teaches. That those who are saved, God has chosen and elected for salvation, brought them to faith, and done everything in their life that's necessary to bring them to heaven. And those who are condemned, it is because they themselves have rejected God. It really isn't that the whole message of Scripture, law, and gospel. Really isn't that the only thing that's compatible with how Scripture pictures God's work as invitation. The Holy Spirit is calling out to us that people might believe and be saved, and he is the one who enables them to do so. A very important question, why are some saved and not others? But yet also a question that on the last day is going to be somewhat of a moot point, because on that day, some will be saved and not others. And so what does our Lord want us to know about that day, that we might be among those who are saved, that we hear his invitation and believe? Well, Jesus shows us here today exactly what that is. He shows us that the Son gives life to those he wishes, those who will hear his voice and rise to life, those who have in this life heard his word and believed. If we think about this teaching of the last day and everything that will happen on that day, I think that there are a couple of challenges to sharing this news with other people, or even to our own understanding. One is, how am I ready, and what exactly is a life that God is pleased with? But I think there's even a first challenge sometimes, which is just absolute ignorance or forgetfulness of the whole idea that the last day, that the day of judgment is coming. If you look at the world around us, is the world around us living in the full knowledge that there is a final day coming, or is everyone living as they always have been living, with merely a thought towards that day of the Lord? And even in the church, even in our own lives, is this something that is at the forefront of our minds, or is it something that we rarely think of, or something that we maybe even hardly ever think of? Ignorance of or forgetfulness about the last day. I suppose it's easier to live in the present. It's easier also to avoid those things that might be fearful. We look at the things that are in front of us today. But the truth that Jesus reminds us of here is that there is a day of judgment coming, a last day when he returns. Not as some have taught that it's going to be the beginning of some earthly reign of perfection, but no, this is the end of all things. This is the one and final day when Jesus comes to raise the dead and judge the world. In fact, at another point, how did he describe it? Didn't he describe it coming like a thief in the night? I hope it hasn't happened to you. I'm sure it's probably happened to some of us that thief has come when we've been gone and taken things. Happened to my grandparents once, they were away on vacation for a couple of weeks, and you know, what a shock to come back and see what don't have anymore. It's a shock Jesus uses that illustration like a thief in the night. And what does he say? If the owner of the house had known at what time the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. And he leaves it for us to supply the logical opposite. So if you don't know what time the thief is coming, you're ready at all times, right? And that's how Jesus concludes. So you also must be ready at all times. So how are we ready? That's the first question we want to answer. First, let's look at what Jesus says here. In the middle of our reading, verse 25, he says, "Amen, amen, I tell you," one of those statements, but he's calling attention to you with those words, "Amen, amen, truly, truly." Listen to this. This is something you want to know and remember. A time is coming, and is here now, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who listen will live. I suppose that's the very first statement in readiness, isn't it? Just acknowledging this is a future day that is coming. It is a real thing. The prophet Jeremiah wrote about the coming destruction of Jerusalem. And he said, you know, people say life goes on like it always has before. God says he's going to destroy Jerusalem, but why should we believe that? Because life goes on as it has before. Yeah, we can look back and know that in 586 BC, Jerusalem was destroyed. No less certain is Jesus speaking to us about that coming day of judgment. What will happen on that day? Those who listen will live. For just as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son to have life in himself. The Father is the one who gave us life in the first place, right? And he has entrusted to the Son the power to bring us back to life. The new creation ready for life in heaven. Because that's the authority that he has. And he has given him authority to execute judgment because he is the Son of Man. Jesus has come into our world to live as one of us, and therefore he will be our judge. Our judge who accomplished salvation for us, our judge who is our brother, our judge who comes also to raise us and to save us. And so, we want to be ready for that day. We want to live as people who would never be found in sin when Jesus would return. We want to live as people who are honoring our Lord in everything that we do and going about his work constantly so that he will not return and be disappointed. Our thoughts, our words, our actions. And we know that's what we haven't done. And so we ask, how can we be ready? How can we find mercy? Is there any comfort for those who so often forget that this day is coming? Well, the comfort is this, that we are ready by faith in Jesus, because he is our Savior. The one who is our judge also knows full well the work that he has done to redeem us from sin. And so for every accusation that the devil might throw against us, Jesus can say, "Those are our sins that I paid for." For every accusation where the devil says these people are not good enough for what you demand, Lord, Jesus can say, "But I did everything well for them." And so that's the confidence that we have. And what does that lead us to do? It leads us to do what results in readiness every day, confessing our sins, living in repentance, looking to the cross of Jesus for our salvation, and then also going to other people with that simple message of law and gospel. We are sinful, but we have a Savior. Inviting them also to confess their sins and receive absolution like us from our Lord Jesus, who gave himself for us. His blood is the payment for our every sin. His blood is our righteousness and salvation. That is the one way to be ready for the judgment, by resting in the word of our Lord Jesus. It's interesting, if we look at the words of Jesus near the end of our reading, verse 29, that he says things a slightly different way. He says, "Those who have done good will rise to live, but those who have practiced evil will rise to be condemned." And we might be a little bit surprised at Jesus speaking that way after he's spoken about us being saved by faith, that now he talks about what we do and God judging us based on what we do. I think it's important that Jesus says that, and that he says it this way. When you think about it, isn't our whole world consumed with righteousness these days? Not necessarily biblical or godly righteousness, but doing with what is right. Sometimes it's called political correctness, sometimes it's called social justice, sometimes it's all sorts of other things. The demand that people be doing what is right in others' eyes, and that we will not put up with people doing what is wrong. And some of that can be a good desire, and some of that can be not so much. Especially in this, many think that their works are good, and they are justifying themselves before God or before whatever they feel responsible to. And they are relying on those works, and they are relying on that goodness that they see in themselves. But is that really good enough? What are our works really worth? As we look towards the end of time, and as we speak with people about this, this is the misconception that we want to address. Misconceptions about what God is pleased with, what a good work really is. What does Scripture say? It says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. That means that no work that a person does, even if it does great good in this world, and that's a good thing, none of those works count for anything regarding salvation with God, if they do not come from a heart of faith. And that also means that the opposite is true. By faith, whatever a person does to God's glory is something that the Lord loves. Especially as Lutherans, we might hear those words of Jesus and pause a moment to ask, what is he saying here? Those who have done good will rise to live, those who have practiced evil will rise to be condemned. And we teach justification by faith, and by faith alone, that we're only saved by faith, that really in the end, God only judges us based on whether faith is there or not. So yet, what is the truth that Jesus is teaching here? If you think of his demand or his statement of what God expects, those who have done good will rise to live. What does it mean to do good? What does it mean to do good in the eyes of God? Is it nothing less than to be completely perfect in every thought that we've ever had, every word we've ever spoken, every deed we've ever done? That is the only sense in which God can say that those who have done good will rise to live, and that we might be included in that. To do good is to be perfect. So how can anyone be saved? The answer comes from what Jesus said a little bit earlier. Another one of his amen, amen statements. Verse 24, amen, amen. I tell you, anyone who hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life. He is not going to come into judgment, but has crossed over from death to life. And so we see that salvation is by faith. By faith, God sees us with the goodness of Christ. Without faith, he sees only evil. And therefore, those who believe have eternal life, and therefore there is nothing bad that will come to them in the judgment. And therefore, what's also true, God's judgment remains just. God remains holy. He does not become a God who excuses evil. He remains a God who takes out his wrath on evil, because he took out that wrath on his own Son, in our place, on the cross. And if we want proof that this is all taken care of, the proof is found in the fact that Jesus has risen from the dead. The grave cannot contain him anymore, because the payment for sins have been made. And so if we seek to do good, what is then the definition of a good work? Isn't what a believer does out of love for God, not fear, in accordance with God's word? It is, first of all, what a believer does by faith, out of love for God. Again, great acts that people do in this world may help with life in this world, but they mean nothing without faith. Someone who is incredibly wealthy might give $1 billion to help the poor, and that may help them indeed, but counts for nothing in God's eyes if it is not done by faith. And yet the simplest act that we can do, even if it doesn't accomplish accomplish much in the eyes of the world, is precious in God's sight. Jesus says, even if you give a cup of cold water to a child because they're my disciple, you will certainly not lose your reward. A good work is what a believer does in faith and love for God, and it's that which we do according to God's word. There are all sorts of things that we might do. If they're against God's will, of course, they're not pleasing to Him. If God's will says nothing about it, then it may or may not be something pleasing to God. But if it is something that God has stated in His will that is pleasing to Him, that we know that this is something God wants us to do. And I suppose for our guide there, can we think of the Ten Commandments and the way that Martin Luther used them as a summary of God's will? Not so much the do not do this part of the commandments, but what is it that God would have us do to show our love for Him? What is it that takes God's gift that He has given, described in each of the Ten Commandments, and uses that to God's glory? You shall have no other gods. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. We honor God when we set Him up, having first place in our hearts, when we don't misuse His name, but instead we tell His praises, when we remember the Sabbath day in our own way in this age, making every use we can of His word and sacrament and encouraging one another. Honor your father and mother. That is a positively stated commandment, right? We honor all those in authority and make their life, their governing, easy, not a burden. You shall not murder. We take God's gift of life, and we honor it by loving one another, by never being abusive, but always loving and comforting, by speaking well of one another and helping one another in our needs. You shall not commit adultery. We take God's gift of marriage, whether that's something we enjoy or not. We hold it up as God's gift, and we seek that in practice just as God has established all people from the beginning of time. And so on, with each of the commandments, we take God's will and say, how might I do this God's glory? Because it isn't true, brothers and sisters, that God wants our good works. He created us to do them. And now, because Jesus is our Savior, we have the privilege of seeking to do them, not in fear over our salvation, but in love and thankfulness to God. Why are some saved and not others? The answer is found in our reading. The Son gives life to those He wishes, and we can say nothing more that. But doesn't it show God's salvation is completely by grace? If the cause of salvation were in us, we would be always uncertain of where we stood with God. But because the cause of our salvation is in God's eternal grace, it is something that we can rest ourselves on with 100% confidence. And then God does His work in us. He warns us the judgment is coming. He shows us how perfection is required for salvation. He assures us that we are saved by faith in Jesus, who is our righteousness. And therefore, what can we do? Therefore, we look forward to the judgment without fear. We look forward also to the resurrection and to life. And therefore, we trust in Jesus' perfect work that forever comes before God's throne as our very own. Amen. Please stand. The peace of God that transcends all understanding will guard your hearts and minds by faith in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. On page 14, we sing the Create in Me.
Thank you.
day, 100 years ago, at the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, the end of World War I was declared, and Armistice Day was celebrated. After the war to end all wars was proved not to be, it became Veterans Day. And so on this occasion, we pray for our veterans and for peace from God. We pray. Everlasting protector and defender, we thank you for our military veterans. Through them, you have provided us with blessings that people around the world envy. But the presence of our veterans also reminds us of your warning that wars and rumors of war will continue until the end of time. In your mercy, keep war from our shores and frustrate the plans of all those who would cause us terror. Lord of the nations, we ask that you would continue to bless our country with men and women who are willing to go to distant and dangerous places to protect us from those who would do us harm. We pray that you will continue to bless us with veterans who offer faithful and selfless service. Be with our veterans as they return home and continue their march through life, especially those wounded in body or spirit. May they receive the support and care they deserve for their sacrifice. Protect them from the ambush of sin and the firepower of Satan. Give them the health and strength they need to carry out the missions in life that you have laid before them. Lord, be their shield and strength, their guide and their rear guard. Give to them the peace that surpasses all understanding as they place their trust in you. When their tour of duty in this world is over, give them the order to come home. Bring them to where there are no more wars. Grant unto them this blessing, that when we are listening to taps being played over their graves, may they be listening to the joyous trumpet call of God and the music of heaven's choirs. We ask that you grant this for Jesus' sake. And Lord, in the light of recent tragedies in our nation, we also ask that you would comfort all those who are affected and cause your gospel to be heard and believed. Cause that gospel of salvation to revive and reflect and refresh all people. Send messengers of your grace throughout the world that the light of your glory may rise on those who are covered in darkness. Let your good news be proclaimed to every people in every place, that they may be gathered into your kingdom and confess Jesus Christ as Lord, the one who lives and reigns with you and the Father, the one who has also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. On page 15, we continue with the service of the Lord's Supper. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good and right that we should at all times and in all places give you thanks, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who preserves his church to the end of time when he will come again as king to judge all people and take his own to glory. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song. Given for you, do this in remembrance of me. Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen.
Thank you.
thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us with this Holy Supper. We pray that through it you will strengthen our faith in you and increase our love for one another. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Those are the announcements. Please take a moment to greet one another now.